think we're gonna do it. Man, and hey. No, it's all. Hey, go ahead and hang up the phone. You'll find it, okay?
Okay. All right, I'll hang it up.
Okie dokie.
There you are, my friend. How you doing?
All right, man. Hey, got on from a nice little trip. How about yourself?
All right, so man, we're coming back.
What are you looking at on those screens?
Hey, what we're doing is we're coming back for part two. Like I said, Donald, he had been on a trip, and he had a partner, and she was somewhere else, and they had to check in. Everything's good, so they're he's back. This is part two. So this is, you know, we ended off part one. This is part two of our deep dive discussion. What we're really looking at is Alan Watts' four or five big philosophical questions. And we were kind of interwrapping it with a dream that I had about this walk through the forest. And we wound up somehow at the Columbian Exchange, ending off our discussion of Alan Watts' big questions. And of course, I got to go back and find these big questions again here. So here they are.
Well, that's very important. I mean, you know, the Alan Watts thing. I mean, you've been a huge fan of Alan Watts, and I've watched one of his big videos. And hey, it's very thought provocative, and we've discussed it. And so, yeah, without those questions, I'm not for sure which ones, but the Columbia Exchange and all those things all came from the same ideas. So, do you have a specific one you'd like to start with?
Well,
the
first one we were talking about, and of course, you know, and we probably hadn't really done with it, but we were talking about it in the context there. But what we were talking about is, and let me go back to these big questions. The big questions, the big serious four or five are, and of course, the only one we looked at was the first one is, who started it? And then, of course, you know, the point of it is that you and I were having this discussion, and we talked about the path, and we talked about different ways to look at it. And of course, you know, we've talked about the Christianity perspective, and then we looked at it from the Eastern perspective, that there's different paths, and each different path is different religions, and of course, you know, they believe totally different than the way Western people believe, you know, and which is totally different. We believe that, you know, that from a by and large, Christian people believe that we were injected into this world by God that created us from dirt or from other forms, you know. But now the rest of the world, a lot of the world doesn't believe like that. They believe that we're organic, that we came out of it. And of course, a lot of people don't like China, which is a lot of where that thought kind of comes from, is because it's China, you know, it's red, it's communist, you know, there's this whole weird way they look at the world is that, you know, individuals are not as important as the whole thing, but individuals are everything, you know. It's just like, it's weird, you know. Of course, this Americans just don't have a really good taste for it, unless they get the smoking pot, then they go, oh, that's what they was talking about. But anyway, so the big questions here. One is, who started it? And we were talking about, you know, God and these different things. And I'm not that deep into Christian religion, and I don't really think like that anymore. I used to when I was younger. I kind of grew up in it, but I wasn't really indoctrinated in it too well. My dad wasn't too religious, My mother definitely wasn't. My grandparents never went to church. So I didn't really go all the time. I went there with my aunts and uncles sometimes. I went there with Bible school and stuff like that. You know, it's more kind of a recreational thing for me. I didn't really get it. It really wasn't what it scared me. It's a very scary religion. It's all this, you're going to, you know, if you don't do what some little, you know, something says, if you make a mistake, God's going to kill you. So I didn't really like that religion. It's just me, you know, I'm too autistic for it. Okay. I don't really get that kind of authoritarian shit. I don't like authoritarian stuff. You don't come to me with that. And you come to me and we're both human beings. We both kill to eat. We both eat stuff and we shit it out our ass. You know, don't come to me with this telling me you're better than me, you know, because your daddy gave you money and my daddy didn't give me money or whatever, you know, whatever it is. So, you know, the thing of it is that I don't like that kind of thing. I don't like, it's just not suitable for me. Now, there are a lot of tenets of Christianity that I think are great. I love the Christianity part of Christianity, you know, the part that Jesus says, like the Sermon on the Mount. I mean, I can vibe with that, bro. You know, I get it. I get the Ten Commandments, you know, and I get the Sermon on the Mount. So if that's Christianity, I dig it, you know. So now, but now who started it? I don't know who started it. I don't think. Hold on. One of the things that I threw out there, who started it? This is me. Then I'm going to toss it off to you and let you go wherever you want to go with it. But who started it? The older I get, the more I examine it. I think that we're kind of like those South American farmers, Americas, you know, people from the lower Americas, that created corn. They refined a way to get that seed. They said for generations and generations and different people refining it to get it to be where it was at. They started out with a piece of grass that had a little knobby on it, and they figured out how to grow that thing into something bigger. And the scientists today have carried it even further. And then that seed can be slung out into the universe and somewhere or the other. We call it the Big Bang. It could be any number of things. And it could be that a creator created that seed, or that it's just something that organically happens, like the grass seed that started before a creator was ever put into it. One way or the other, that's the way that I believe we got here. Now, was there a God involved in it that put that seed out there? That's for somebody else to discover. You don't need it with my theory, okay? So now you can have it in there, and I think it's very warming sometimes, because I would love to know that when I die, it's not the end of me. I don't want to just think that that's it, but you know what? I understand realistically that it could be. I like to entertain it sometimes, but I don't entertain it all the time. Practical things, I do like some of the Christianity stuff. The history of Judaism is not that important to me, because I'm not Jewish. I'm Northern Europe. I'm pagan. I'm a heathen. You know, I grew up out there running around the rocks and the hills and the trees, and that's probably why I see these trails out there. But so who started it all? I think that a number of things came together, and maybe it was a seed, and maybe it wasn't, and maybe someone created it, and maybe they didn't, I don't know, but somehow or the other we got here, and we're pretty smart monkeys. That's what I think. What do you think?
Well, I mean, from the prospect of, we're talking about our current civilization, our current situation, the United States of America, including Hawaii and Alaska, are mostly Christianity. Now, that's a black book, and there's a certain set of rules in there. Now, you know, when the pilgrims showed up, they didn't believe anything in that black book. There wasn't a black book. It was the pilgrims thing. They were trying to escape the idea of persecution. It's just currently this conservative Christianity that believes that the only religion that is absolutely true. I am agnostic. If there's something bigger than me, and if you just look up at the night sky, you are not the only important SOB in this world. You may not mean anything but a tiny little cog. You can imagine yourself as I am the master of the universe. Most likely, you're just this tiny little cog and you're not important at all. The acceptance of, I just want to live the life I have. I want to do the best I can. I want to feel I moved things forward. There's several movies about pay it forward that makes you feel better. Does that mean that's going to give you an afterlife? No. Makes you feel better only because it makes you feel better. The whole universe does not center around you, but at the same time, you can accept, hey, there are times that you're selfish. There's times you're unselfish. But how do you see yourself in this life? The Christianity thing is all about them trying to make themselves feel better. Now, our comments was, I was raised in a Church of Christ. I am going to their beliefs. Don't matter. Don't believe them. You know, I've been to Southern Baptist, I've been to many Pentecost. They all have the same tenets, but they're still underlining, obey me. That's not right to me. I'm sorry. If you're given free will, you've got the right to make choices. Some religions say you can't, some say you can. But now, just for a moment, like you're talking about the Native American, imagine with the Native American thing, and I don't know how many listeners will know many Native American, quote, religious structures, you know. Imagine if the Europeans haven't won, and the Indians, the quote, unquote, and I hate to just use that as a generic tone, but imagine if they had won, and their religion was the one in the book in every hotel room you went and stayed. Think about that as a deep dive.
Yeah, that's interesting because, you know, it's of course, you know, if the world would have there is even with my fascination with that culture, and of course a lot of them didn't die, a lot of them did. You know, and of course, you know, again, that goes back to the whole survival of the fittest. You know, I don't know. It's kind of a weird thing. But yes, I have entertained the world. Of course, I do it sometimes with AI. It's been very good for me to help me look at those things that I can't necessarily envision. You know, because I'm limited. I mean, I have a great imagination. And like I said, me and you both have been voluminous readers over the years. And you know, of course, and you can use your brain, but, you know, the older I get, you know, and the more we learn about psychology, there's a lot you can accomplish with an image. I mean, you can put things subtly in the background. As I've gotten older, of course, that's what I do for a living now, really, is create images.
An image is worth more than 1,000 words. The old thing is it's worth 1,000. No, an image can convey so much more if the mindset meets. Sorry to interrupt.
No, you're perfect. Look here. So now on the screen here, we're about to go into it again. This is another batch of this trail. I've spent a lot of time with this trail through the woods. You know, of course, this is a modern time, but now this is a modern time, but showing an ancient trail that had been there before. And in just a minute here, I love the cave type structures, you know, the rock around you, rock houses. And of course, you know, a lot of people that were beautiful, lucky enough to live in such a beautiful place as that. Because, you know, there was a human being that spent a hominid and then a human being and probably an Neanderthal and probably all kinds of variations of all of those and many other things and animals and cows and whatever the hell else that went through there. They got to spend a little bit of time there as a structure. You know, maybe it rained and they got to spend some time there. So whenever I see a path, you know, like this, and I see a structure specifically in places like, you know, South America, or in Africa, or in Europe, or even in North America, there's a lot of places. But places like this, you know that there's been other creatures there. And you can't see it with your eyes, but you can imagine it, And you can find it. These archaeologists now have been able to go in and find things. I mean, it's just truly amazing what they found. But now what I'm getting into now is case. And I like to interpret what I'm seeing now is like Spain and France. Because there's still rock. And there's these early caves down through here. Now, I get a little bit exaggerated with some of these. But these are rock houses, and these are, you know, who knows, AI worked on it, but it's feasible, and we know from just exploring pictures of real stuff that it's similar to this. So go into thinking about this as a hominid, and you're what that first batch that came out of Europe, just right after, you know, there maybe it was like a cessation in the ice age there for a while. We actually go back 26,000. Go back to the time of Neanderthals, parts of the Neanderthals. Go back 30,000 years, 40,000 years. Let's go back 60,000 years, okay? The animals that are alive then. And this is before the Ice Age started, before there was an Ice Age that was huge across the whole United States of America, okay? And Europe. So this is the time whenever there's an expansion of growth. How many years ago? 60,000 years ago, whatever. So you're way back in time. You know, most things, 5,000-10,000 years, even rock are gone. You know, it's after so long, you know, a particular carving or whatever. But this is just way back. You're talking about amount of time you can't even comprehend. You know, just imagine this, like the time of the Poverty Point people down there in Louisiana was 1,250,000 days ago. Okay. So 1.25 million years ago, 1.25 million years ago, days ago, excuse me, not years. Sorry. Days ago. Well, you know, 60,000 years, you start figuring that up and it's a whole lot, you know, it's millions and millions and millions of days ago, many, many, many different spins around the, our axis. A lot of days ago, a long, 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 long time ago, whenever there was the first beings, the first true, you know, headed in our direction hominids. These are things that are walking upright. You know, a long time ago, you know, they started doing that 3 million years ago, but you're way up there 60,000 years ago. So it's pretty advanced, but it's not like the human beings you have now. Some people say that human beings were around that we have now were 200,000, 300,000 years ago. I don't know. Maybe it is, maybe it's not. I don't know. I know that they were a little bit different even in the time of Utsi the Iceman 5,000 years ago. But their brains may not have been. I don't know. Let's just assume they are for a second. You got a brain like mine and yours 60,000 years ago without all this bullshit we got. And you're there. You don't have your iPhone. You don't have whatever the hell else. You got a little belt on. You got some mushrooms in it or whatever. And you're making a trip up to your, you know, the other village to deliver a message to the chief or whatever. You got to go through here. You know, it's some pretty wild stuff. Thank you, mate. Are you there, Donald? Or no?
Oh yeah, no, I'm here. I mean, I was just loving exactly what you were talking about. Because you was on, what, 60,000 years ago. Well, there's actually a movie called 65K with Adam Driver. You know, the dark guy from the Star Wars movies. He's a great actor. But, yeah, I mean, their thing was exactly the things you're showing actually kind of meets a lot of what is in that movie, but it's called 65K. Have you seen it? And that's all I was trying to ask is, dude, you are so close and you haven't mentioned it yet and you've probably not actually seen it, but they did a lot of that research. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, I've never heard of it, but I've studied that time period. It's a very fascinating time period, you know. But we don't really know much about it. We can only guess. But look at this shirt. This is a different kind of a man than what we are. You know, he's easing down through here. This is that trail I've been talking about. And every human being, see, this is what I believe. Okay, we're gonna go a little bit deeper with it. Let's go deeper into the cave.
Go ahead, man.
Well, everything on this planet, again, it wasn't. We weren't injected here. Again, if you cut me open and if you cut a deer open, you're gonna find a lot of the same bullshit. And what I'm trying to say is that this planet is all if there was an alien ship where he come up and park, you know, right out there about where the moon's orbit is, about 250, 300,000 miles out, and start just sit there and start staring at us. You know, everybody on this planet would become we. We have got this common enemy. But that's not the way things are, you know. I mean, the way I think is that we are one fucking thing all the time, because we are all facing death all the time. But a lot of us are comforted more in the comfort of humanity will go on, you know, through our children, and things will keep getting better and better and better, you know. And but that, sometimes we forget to do our part to make things better. Sometimes that making better could be realizing that we are just one fucking thing all the time, and not just whenever there's a funeral or when there's an alien parked out there, man. But we're all one fucking
thing. No. I mean, you're absolutely correct. So, yeah.
I mean, life is better. Like, not everybody can look at it like that, because most people, you know, they're out to gain that day. And a lot of times I can't look at it like that. I've got to get bacon home, and if I can fuck you out of $10, it buys my family bacon for the day. You know, it is what it is. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Sometimes you gotta live. You know, we all gotta.
Well, you know, and the thing of it is, you know, everybody says, well, I'll use all this up. My kids will have what they want. If you want to leave it for your later generations, well, if you use too much now, you will not have any later generations. The later generations, nature will determine when you are here and not. It's been proven many, many times. Look, extinctions and stuff. Now, whether we caused them or nature decided to create us, we were seeded here by aliens. It doesn't matter. We are living our life. We're living what we perceive as reality, regardless if your red is my red, brown is my black. It doesn't matter. We're all perceiving it as we live on this tiny ball. To think that I can use it all up and leave something beyond. Now, I have the best intentions. I did my best with my kids, and I think they're doing pretty good. I feel I had many, many failings, but I can admit that and just, hey, if I just passed on, whether there's another tomorrow or not, I feel I made a tiny difference. Now, that don't mean I'm suicidal or any of those things. I want to grow and get beyond. But to just sit around and wait for everybody to do things for you, see, there's that difference between leadership and followers. If we had a catastrophe today, EMPs, the sun half-ass exploded, the moon moved in, any number of those disaster movies that are all a part of the imagination, you know, you can imagine the worst, expect the best, and just figure it's going to be somewhere in the middle. That's the way I've always believed. And it's like, well, hey, if I was called, I would try. If I didn't, so, well, hey, I'm not one of those that's going to too much worry about it. All I can do is, if there's karma, going back to the religion thing, I hope I have received the next reincarnation in the next future generation. If that's not real, then I will never know. You know, going back to where the other ones are doing it, they had just as much right to believe that as well. When the end comes, if it comes, we won't ever know, because all you can do is live in this moment. Not yesterday, not tomorrow. You can plan for tomorrow. But what are you doing right now? How do you improve yourself? How do you not improve yourself? How do you just sit your ass on the couch? We were talking about, I was like, man, I just got home from a long trip. My ass is just sitting on the couch.
I get that for sure. Of course, I've been out of a vehicle since yesterday, but I had a long trip yesterday. I put about, you know, 250 miles on one. But I'm going to tell you, that stuff hurts. You know, of course, young people don't understand it. But when you do get older, that thing is a different thing. But now, up on the screen right here, there is, I have some rock art, rock house cave art. rock house art, so cave art. And of course, I asked for it in different colors, and I asked for it in people who have been watching the screen who have seen like some geometric features or some animal, you know, directions that we've carried it. And some of this is just whatever AI wanted it to go. I think this is the case of AI, what it wanted to go. And again, this is just a, it's an ancient well-worn path. And then, another word, there was another word used to describe ancient for the forest, a pine forest with large old trees, sparsely populated. But now, you know, of course, it throws in things every once in a while. Now, this one right here is kind of funny because this is one, the one where I said candy apple red cave art. And it didn't know what candy apple red meant, you know, so it put a candy apple there, I guess. I don't know. That was kind of weird. That was
yeah, but that is candy apple red.
Yeah.
And it looks like an apple. I mean, it's still interpretation, but go back to your dreams. You know, you was asking, you keep seeing that your dream, excuse me, if you ever actually see the destination in your dream,
probably won't be good, will it?
Robert, I can't get it.
Now, what you're getting to here is some earlier examinations of the well-worn path. And when I was looking at it, I was like, I get what it was doing there, but it also kind of looks like a creek path. But that was well-worn. You know, it wanted you to know that that path has been beat on a lot. You know, of course, that's a weird way of doing it. Of course, that would happen in certain places. You know, and that's why I put into stones, because I knew that there would be water near. I don't really think you can have much of a, it's hard to go on a place on earth where there's humans and there not be water. So there's got to be, like right here, all of this what you see on the screen right now is stuff that was influenced by water. Yeah, so there's water near, and here's some of those old pine trees. So they did a good job on that. And there's some old stones there and I put stones in all of it. You know, sometimes I didn't ask for anything particular on a lot of it. I wanted it to use its imagination from what it can deduce. But now some of that stuff is just so fascinating to me. And all of these images, I mean, they're kind of spiritual for me in some ways. I mean, because I feel like when I look at that, it's kind of like, I know.
Well, I mean, I feel them too. I mean,
but now, I know that there's been, I know some kind of creature, Donald, has walked along and has seen something just like that. Like, whenever we were young, and I don't want to get into a discussion of it, just think about it as a metaphor right now. You know, people out there, like with us, we were out there with, you know, walking through the woods, and we saw this thing, and we thought, well, no one ever has ever seen that before, and they probably have. You know, they just put whatever, something like this right here, and, you know, and of course, those moments are frozen out there. There's this scene right here. There's an animal that has seen this scene right here. Some kind of animal, maybe a bug, I don't know. Something has been somewhere that's been similar to this. Now, there's another tree in here I added. It's called a Balboas tree or something like that. It's in Africa. And sometimes I asked these old pine trees to be mixed with that. So that's how come some of these pines look weird. So anyway, what are you doing? What do you think about now? What are they? Are you looking at these images?
Yeah, I'm sitting there watching them. And, you know, I mean, I do not disagree with you. Somewhere, and it doesn't have to be here on this particular little blue ball. I mean, see, that's what you and I was discussing, was the universe is all connected. It's bigger than just us. Those images you're seeing, all I was trying to say is that I do not disagree with you. Somewhere in this infinite universe. Now, if you want to get technical, infinity means forever. Any combination of images that this AI can create could be somewhere in the infinity of the universe, because there's so much of, quote,
infinity that everything you see could, yes, something okay. has so seen let, it exactly
let me
that.
Throw this at you. Let me throw this at you now. Let's imagine that we are in a simulation and we're asking this computer to generate things, but it's just giving us pictures from the rest of the universe. Maybe it's feeding me this. Really, it didn't have to invent this. This thing, maybe this computer that's generating this is tied into a matrix. Who knows? Maybe this thing is like the collective conscious of me talking about me being on this trail. Here's what I'm trying to say. The other day, I said, generate an image of people generating an image of whatever. And I was like, holy shit. Then I was talking about this, the question that Elon Musk was asked, are we in base reality? He's like, no, we're not in base reality. Very small chance we're in one in a billion chance that we're in base reality. This is the richest dude in the world. One of the smartest people you ever meet, probably. That's what he believes. He's looked at it. He's looked at the, empirical evidence, just like we've looked at it. Some of us are not as bold enough to say, probably not.
Well, but now, we've had a couple discussions about, there was that quantum, it was a YouTube video, and they was talking about, we were looking at an 8D dimension at a 3D way. Well, Elon, now this is kind of just going to touch on that, and then if we want to follow back, we're going to have to get some real callbacks. But maybe he just realized that, but now he's still a being of us. He's still stuck in our 4D universe, but maybe he can sense there's the 8D, and that's what he's trying to achieve. Kind of like Einstein and a few other of these, quote, Tesla super geniuses, they sent something a little outside of where we are today. So now, again, now politically speaking, nothing. We ain't talking about it. Him personally and his ideas, see, I kind of think he is kind of the new person that can sense that little bit of out of sync stuff, like those old school super inventors. Now,
let me just throw this out there. Just because somebody's good at technical things doesn't mean they should be a leader of the world. See, that's the problem with Americans. They want somebody to come do the work for them. Americans are some lazy fucks. They're like, they want an authoritarian leader now. You got to remember who your audience is. You got to understand that he's not some saint. He's not perfect. This guy's, he can do one thing. Actually, what he's good at is making money.
I was talking about the progression of the human race. I was talking about his idea.
I think it'd be easy to give him too much. I think there's a many other people that are doing something similar. But now I was giving him props. Just, you're going to go further with it than what I'm going to go with.
Exactly the props you were trying to give him, I was just saying. Absolutely.
It may be. I want you to explain, further, but just the thing that I was saying about him is that all I'm saying is that everybody knows Elon Musk. He's of Tesla. And he thinks that there's a 1 in a billion chance that we're in base reality. Now, there are a lot of people that are fanboys of him. There are a lot of people that love him. I'm kind of a fan of him, but I also think he's a nut. So I'll give him the props of being a financial genius, selling PayPal and figuring out how to get other people to help him make money and become a legend, which he will be. But I don't think he's the best thing ever. I mean, I think there's other people that can do. I think that I'm glad he's here. But again, I don't have a tendency to, giving people way too much. I don't even give myself that much. I wouldn't, because I'm not that. But I don't want everybody to get the impression we're worshiping this guy. Okay. He's a great guy. He's smart, but, I don't think, those are not the kind of skills you need to be a great leader, in my opinion, but you may disagree. What do you think about Elon Musk? Would you want Elon Musk to be president, or what do you think?
No, I'm agreeing
with everything you just said, I was trying to say that it's kind of like prophets, Einstein, Tesla, Edison. Through history, you have people who can see a little deeper to advance mankind. That don't mean they should be leaders. I don't think the man thought he should be a leader. It's just, I think he sees a vision beyond us. Every one of those inventors through time that there's all these series over, Musk should be involved, but he is a weirdo. But every one of those inventors have been a little weird because they see reality a little different. So his basis of, he don't think we're based reality. Well, maybe he's right. But he still is a individual living in this current reality. Maybe he sees it a little different. He can't explain it. Authors have tried to write visions of a reality that, what is the thing of imagination? How can you make up these images in your head? Well, because you have to imagine it. Well, where do those, that imagination come from? Someone had to start it at some point to go, yellow. Wait, yeah, I mean, you had to invent everything in the you see in your head. It's always a mind movie. You are a consciousness in a bio robot. Humanity, we break down, but it's still, whether someone reached out and touched us and created us, you're still a consciousness. Where does it go above or beyond? Well, I don't guess it matters, because if you can't remember before, then I wasn't here before, so I might as well enjoy today, but I better enjoy it as best I can. Well, there's so many of those things that are involved with what's important to you, and I think that's where a whole lot of that comes from.
You know, some people, though, like you said, now I want to go to... you know, which is another part of this, is these big philosophical questions. But now some people are, you know, you mentioned this kind of like with Elon Musk being in the pantheon of these great technical thinkers. And I don't know that I think he's there. Maybe he is. He could very well could be. If he can put something on Mars, then I'll change my mind, because he'll do... He'd be a thinker or a doer. Maybe he'll be a doer. And that's more important than anything to me. So I admire him for that. But where I really wanted to go with it, though, is that, you know, there are some people out there, you know, and maybe it is Elon Musk. Maybe I'm jealous of him. I don't know. I'm not going to judge. I can't argue either way, because I don't know. But there are certain people out there, and I've talked about this before earlier, and maybe this episode, or maybe the first part of this, and you're talking about it with Elon Musk, but some people are connected. And I've done it before. That's how this whole trail thing came up. And you've done it before in your own ways. And I think that we all can and should, because we are all connected to this one thing. But sometimes reality, you know, will give you a little shot. It'll pull back their skirt, pull back the stage curtain, and let you see what's going on. And sometimes you don't understand it. And this is what this is to me. This is a revelation, not really a revelation, but a peek behind the scenes. It's something that's going on in my mind. Now, again, it's my perspective. Somebody else may hear it and go, well, that's completely dumb. Well, that's your opinion. I'm like the dude. Well, you know, that's just like your opinion, man. You know, but now some people, other people, sometimes, not me, but like the Buddha or whoever you want to talk about, and maybe Elon Musk, maybe George Washington. I don't know whoever your genius is. You go, that person, the universe, they have they have figured out a way to tap into the collective unconscious. They know what everybody's thinking, and somehow they line up to be at the right place at the right time to speak it at that moment. And then, you know, that one little thing that somebody speaks to you whenever they're being heartful or says, and you hear it, you go, holy cow, and it changes you in a small way. You can't fully comprehend it, but you know it was deep, and you go, God, I want to, here's how I can use that to do, like we're talking about with Elon Musk. Here is how I can use that in reality to be beneficial to me. And then you use that, and other people are impacted by it. And then it gets on and on and on and on, and it grows and it grows and it grows and gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and more complex. And then it's, and then, you know, everybody says it's got to be revival, go back to the beginning of it. And that's how religions get started. That's how the whole thing gets started, is that people that have a tap into it, and others, somehow or the other, it just happens to wind up and get tapped into other things. It makes sense. It knows how to use everything else that's going on and say it all at the right point in time for it all to connect. And I think the universe kind of gives us that. Now, I think it's easy to also get trapped with it, because the universe will tell you that water is stronger than rock.
See, you just described God and the devil.
You know, so you have to tell me more about that, because all I was talking about is water going across rock. So tell me how I was describing the God and devil. Tell me.
Well, listen, here's the thing about, you know, the failings of the religion. And, you know, we were just talking about, you know, the greatness of everyone is connected. Everyone is, you know, they kind of feed back to each other. You may not remember yesterday or your last life. Next day, you got the good side. And then we were talking about Elon Musk. I was trying to say, Elon is just, I'm not saying he's a great guy or anything. When I'm trying to build a religion about him, but I was comparing to the great scientific advancements of mankind. But you're correct in terms of, it's so easy to fall into the authoritarianism. You know, that guy, he becomes a religion, and they're like, hot damn, you've got God and the devil. It was a great description, but now it also goes back to, if the Europeans never showed up, what would be the quote religion in the Americas or the United States, in the number of them? Just because of the, yeah, like the pictures you're talking about, it's a path. Who knows what and where it came from, but the idea of good and evil, that's where I always kind of thought, like, is that where good and evil came from? Or did folks just kind of forget, you know what? It happens. Maybe Forrest had it right.
You know, I never did really think about the good and evil. Yeah, I never really thought about all that stuff. I've always been more academic. You know, for years of my life, all I've done, I spent with books. And then in my 20s, I spent books, you know. And of course, that's what I did for a living, being a professional student for years. And so I don't really, there's a lot of things that I don't understand. You know, I delayed having children because of being in school. I wanted to just deep dive. And a lot of the stuff that I did was just deep dive kind of stuff. So I don't know anything but that. Like the semester, like I work on projects now because I still kind of work on a semester kind of thing. I go in and I deep dive in there and, you know, and just deep dive into it and just get dirty, you know, just kind of just go deep. And then I get tired of it. Then I just come out of it, you know, and go do something else. So it just takes an intense focus, specifically when I'm sober, you know. And that's the thing with me is, you know.
Well, all good and evil is just morality. Good and evil is morality of what do you consider good, what do you consider. But no. I understand what you were saying.
I hadn't got there yet. But, you know, there's the alcohol part of me, and I don't know how to suss this apart. But I couldn't see it until I drank alcohol and studied the true crime stuff over the last several months. Now I haven't had alcohol in over a month, but I didn't understand, you know, your brain is different when you drink. And it's been several years since I drank anything. But, and I've been around, because I wasn't even around people that drink. I just couldn't, it's people that are drunk, I'm intolerant of it. In fact, my son was like over the, he came here and stayed with me for a couple of days. And he was like, you know, every time I would get drunk, you would just get pissed. I'm like, yeah, I don't want to see that kind of stuff. Do it, but don't fucking do that shit near me. It's dangerous. It makes me nervous. I'm too much of a fucking control freak. I'm Euclidean. I like shit in a fucking perfect square or rectangle. I just don't like all that shit, you know? So, but now Good and Evil, let me go back to this. I never really thought about it. I had been so academic. It was all philosophical questions for me. It wasn't real, like the Elon Musk thing of being real, creating shit that actually takes off from the ground and explodes and goes into the sky. It's all been academic. You know, you talk about how you've done the technical things, but I was in school for all this time. I'm a thinker. I design plans. I don't really, you know, I don't really do it. I kind of get it set up and going, and then I let other people do it after I kind of, you know, test it out. You know, I'm kind of a machinist, but I don't create machines. I create, it's like a regimen. It's like an exercise program, like a marketing plan. It's something you create, this thing that you unfold, and you know, so it's fake. You know, it's not really fake. It's just it's not something you touch specifically. So like, you know, that's where my mind is used to working, and there is no good or evil in that world. In that world, it's just what it is. It's just what works. You know, there is no judgment about, you know, am I being bad? Am I being good? I mean, there's none of that. You just do what's respectful. You do what's, you know, makes sense, what goes along with the plan, you know. But now this good and evil shit is deeper than that, bro. There are actual human beings that get off on killing people, that get off on raping people. It's a control thing. There, I didn't really understand it because I get away from it. Whenever I sense, I have like a little, you know, a little radar system. Someone's acting like that, I'm like, I'm going to get the fuck away from them. I'm talking about, they ain't got to act a whole lot like that, but a little bit like that, and I'm gone. Because those people are dangerous. Even a little bit of it, man, they'll get your ass in some trouble, number one. And number two, they got loose lips, you know, because they're just, evil people are very different than my interpretation of evil. Now, what's your interpretation of good and evil? Let's just start there. What's good and what's evil? What's your interpretation of evil? Let's start there for just to put a line in the sand.
Well, my interpretation is just, again, my personal morality. My parents did their best to teach me. This is the morals of the world. And then I had to interpret it based on my reality. That, like, well, I mean, see, you don't just kill animals for fun. You kill them for food. You don't just kill people. Oh, wait, that's wrong. No one had to tell me that was wrong, but I was taught that, you know. But now, is that a basis because I thought it, or is it because I was taught that? Then you got just the no stealing. Well, I don't want nobody stealing shit that's mine. Again, is that what's moral? Is that just what we thought, or is that just us? See, there's all those deep thoughts. So there's so much of good and evil that is mixed in that we do not know. And the acceptance of this is wine, this and this, and then it ends up with, well, you know what? I really just don't know. It's all because it's either built in, or it's part of nature, or it's part of just society, as what we call our current society. That's such a deep dive into that kind of thing. It's part of me. But when you get up to the higher levels, like the better education. Now, I don't mean going to let someone be in teaching you, because you and I both know, hey, you've got all those PhDs. I went for the technical side. Dude,
I know things more than you, but I will always come help you. And dude, I'd come to you to ask about some of these questions because I want that contrasting view. Because I've seen things, you've seen things, we communication. That is such a bad miss thing, you know, especially when you get to talking between, now, not mates, but like my Mrs. D, we have an awesome communication. I had some when I thought I was young, and, you know, I was young, dumb, and full of cum. I think that's what it was called. And, you know, I had a great relationship with one of my children, not so much with the other, but hey, we still communicate. My grandbabies, oh dude, I've got five of them. Now, I'm the same age as you. Actually, I think I'm only younger, but now my family started so much younger, and then we grew through from the, hey, can I use the phone? All the way up to this technological age. It has changed a whole lot of viewpoints. Evolution over, you know, environment. I still think it all ties back into Moore's Law. Every 10 years, technology will multiply. But now, maybe that applies to sociology, people, civilization, etc., etc. Still there? Hello?
Okay. Thank you.